Hello, everyone, and welcome to another episode of AppSec 101. My name is Andrew Garrett, and I am pleased to be joined today by Diogo Rispoli. Diogo is the Fortify Chief Architect for North America. And Diogo, I've had you on an episode of AppSec 101 in the past. It's nice to have you on again.
Yeah, thank you so much for inviting me. You know, it's been a pleasure to talk with everybody about, you know, topics on AppSec.
Absolutely, yeah. Yeah, so nice to have you on again. Today, our topic is, what is the software supply chain? And so just to set the stage a little bit, Diogo, for our viewers, could you give a brief explanation of what is the software supply chain?
Yeah. Software supply chain are pieces of software, you know, third-party softwares that we can bring to your development process and can help us expedite or make our life easier. You know, produce software quicker, reusing pieces of software that were built by other people, other companies, you know, different groups and organizations. Some of them nonprofit organizations, some of them individuals that are dedicated to you know, deliver that. Some of them organizations that build those software by, you know, as a way to, as a company, as a way to make money. So all those pieces are a part of the software we have in-house, what we could also call a custom code or custom software we build.
Okay, so if I'm understanding this correctly, the software supply chain essentially makes it easier for developers to build software rather than reinventing the wheel or building something for the ground up. They're able to pull in existing components to essentially make their lives a little easier. Is that correct?
Yeah, and make the process faster, right? Because I think that's the main goal with the development today. Make the releases go out quicker and faster.
Yeah, absolutely. So now let's talk about the security of the software supply chain. What are some aspects that may affect the security or the integrity of the software supply chain?
Some of those are open source projects that have many individuals know and unknown contributions to them. Sometimes issues can be introduced by on those, you know, packages or libraries or third-party software we have. And not always the organizations that are building that software have the skills, the knowledge, or the time to investigate all the possible secure issues that are presented on those, you know, on that, you know, particular piece of software. So the main issue is when you have many individuals and you don't have a consistent way to check on the issues you're producing, sometimes you can bring in, you know, issues that can lead to several different type of attack vectors. And sometimes also you can definitely have, you know, malicious individuals, hackers, malicious organizations trying to leverage the nature of collaboration of open source software to introduce, you know, also some sort of issues inside that particular piece of code that can be leveraged by the intentions they have. So that's the two biggest issues. Sometimes we don't have to really investigate the issues we have. Sometimes people take advantage of the nature, the collaborative nature of those projects to introduce, you know, malicious code there and leverage that for attacks and for, you know, invasions and whatever.
So, Diogo, I recently saw a statistic that said as many as 98% of applications contain open source components. So could you talk about that a little bit? What does that mean when you hear that statistic?
Yeah, that for me, that means that we as a software, in the software development world, we've been reusing software a lot, and which is really good. I really like the idea of using collaborative source code and libraries to build our software. The main problem is when you have 98% of the applications produced in the world, I would say, using a piece of pieces of software that we use, we are supposing that those libraries are all safe and all secured and all investigated by security issues, and not always that's the truth. Most of the time we use them, we trust them, but they are not doing the right job to make sure we could trust them. So that's the biggest issue and caveat why using third-party components, open source components, libraries, and whatever.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think the issue that developers sometimes run into is, they assume that these open source, these popular projects, they assume that they're secure. And sometimes we forget to really do our due diligence and think, where is this code really sourced from? And can I trust the quality and the integrity of this source code?
Exactly. Yeah, I completely agree with you. And, sometimes what happens also is we have, an old version of that library that was identified, with a known vulnerability. But since we as developers, we are not paying attention on all those things, all those releases, because that can be overwhelming, right? Sometimes we don't pay attention to those, and because of that, we keep running old versions of that particular library, particular release that were already tagged as vulnerable. In that sense, and we do that because it's sometimes hard to keep up with all the releases, and sometimes it's also hard to change those libraries without breaking or a software that's running and there's no known bugs. So the main issue is we trust on something that's old, that's already vulnerable. We are not testing or not checking for vulnerabilities, and we are opening attack vectors on our application, on our infrastructure as a company, as an organization, and that's a big issue.
Yeah, definitely. And as you mentioned, it can be hard to keep up with all the releases and the vulnerabilities. It seems like, every few weeks there's a new headline about an open source vulnerability. Spring4 Shell comes to mind as a recent one. And it's something that's in the headlines. But what are some things that developers can do to mitigate these risks? Because as you said, it's hard to stay on top of everything. So, what are some testing methodologies and some things that developers can do so they can really be proactive in mitigating these risks?
So while building and compiling their software, they can do some checks, automated checks, to make it easier to spot libraries that are tagged by known vulnerabilities in database like, CV, for example. They can do that. They can enable that on, their pipelines, using GitHub Actions, using automation tied to the process they have to build and deploy software. I'm not particularly using the word DevOps or DevSecOps because sometimes we are not there yet. But every time we have automation on our build and deployment process, we can definitely automate the testing we can do, right? With the brick, for example, you can use GitHub Actions to trigger some free analysis on your projects and make sure you can identify and you can spot some of the known issues you have on those libraries. And now comes to the second part, right? We identify what we will do, what is our risk appetite to solve those problems. Because every time you have a known issue, you can be potentially attacked and you can lose data, and you can having some malicious agent taking control of your application or infrastructure, and sometimes can be even both. So automation is key here, using automation in a pipeline to prevent and block those libraries to be released on your production environment is key to mitigate those risks.
Yeah, and Diogo, you just touched on some of this, but what are some other best practices that developers should have in place to ensure a more secure software supply chain?
Yeah, so trust but verify, right? Trust but verify, I think, is the key here. You can perform different types of verification. I understand sometimes we are not security experts, and so it's hard for us to spot those issues, and that's why automation is key to help us verify. And also, keep internal infrastructure where we can store those libraries that we know and we trust. But the problem is sometimes we know and we trust them today, but tomorrow someone will deliver a proof of concept on a particular vulnerability targeting, some of the libraries you have, libraries, open source components you have on your project. So trust but verify every day. Check those, known databases of issues. Try to read and learn from, the experience, and try to understand, keep up with, all the things you see the news. Develop an internal process on your organization to verify on open source components is key. And that can be, by themselves, or check the libraries by themselves, or that can be using strategies like static analysis, dynamic analysis, alongside with some of those, with the open source scanning and open source verification on your environment. Yeah.
Yeah. And Diogo, I like how you touched on the automation because, like you said, sometimes we're not the security experts, but when you have a team of security experts that can put these rules in place, that allows developers to then go in and have these security gates and kind of know how to best secure their applications without having to be the subject matter expert on, both development and security. So I really like that suggestion. I guess just to wrap things up here, Diogo, I know, here at Fortify, we have some solutions to help with software composition analysis, open source security. Would you mind touching on some of the tools that Fortify has available for anyone looking to secure their software supply chain?
Yeah, so definitely. With Fortify, we have a strategic partnership with Somatype, and with Somatype, you can check all those open source components on the source, while you're building and deploying your projects. We also recently acquired the Bricked, and we talked about the Bricked, across our conversation. And the Bricked is a very nice open source scanning tool that, it's cloud-based first and can help you automatize those, on your pipeline. We also have with Web Inspect, out-of-band, software testing, secure testing, and with out-of-band secure testing, we can also spot and identify some of, issues you can face on your projects, checking on how to exploit some of those issues regarding some of, some of the most common frameworks. So we have with Web Inspect a way to check it. Web Inspect, the name of application security testing tool. We also have with Fortify, the Bricked. We have Sonatype, and ultimately you can even use Fortify to scan the source code of your, open source projects, because most of them are available on public repositories. So scanning that source code can also give you a view of the issues you can have on your the components you're using.
Yeah, absolutely. And, the thing that I hear so much about is this single pane of glass view, right? You have your SAST findings, you have your SCA findings. It's all integrated into one central dashboard, which makes it really nice to kind of have all the findings in one location.
Yeah, with Software Secure Center or the FOD dashboard, you can definitely have that single pane of glass view where you can identify alongside of all the issues for static analysis, dynamic analysis. You can identify your software composition analysis issues there, and that can even, you know, be brought to the IDEs of the developers. So developers can have that information inside their IDEs with a description of the issue, with some, you know, links that they can use to learn more about the particular issue, and even, you know, give you the information of the next known vulnerable, version of that component that can help you to update and upgrade your open source libraries. Yeah. So having that single pane of glass view help you with all of that, you know, in an easier way, I would say.
Yeah, definitely. Well, Diogo, as always, I appreciate your perspective. You bring a lot of experience and knowledge to the table. So always appreciate the chance to have you on and to pick your brain a little bit. So thanks for taking some time today.
Thank you for inviting me, and it's my pleasure.
Absolutely. And to our viewers watching this episode, don't forget to subscribe to Fortify Unplugged. We're always trying to bring you the most up-to-date content, both Fortify-related and, you know, general AppSec industry-related as well. So thank you for joining. Don't forget to like and subscribe, and we'll see you again very soon. Thank you.